Well, hello everybody. Welcome to Zion Lutheran Church in Ann Arbor, Michigan. We are grateful that you are joining us today to celebrate our Lord. We're a congregation in the ELCA, and we are glad that you are joining us along with Pastor Jim, who will be our preacher, Vicar Anna, who will be leading with me, Pastor Vicky, this service. We have our awesome organist, Elgin, and Dr. Nellie Downs will be our minister of the word, and she will also be monitoring a live chat. So if you'd like to add your prayer requests for today, we would love to pray for you. We have Thomas and Eddie up in our tech booth making this possible. So we are just grateful for today. We invite you to get a bowl of water or a candle or anything else that makes you feel as if you are worshiping and inviting Christ right into your living room or near your phone or wherever you are enjoying this worship service. So we may as well begin.
All right, let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Please join us in our call to worship. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless God's holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all God's benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases,
who redeems your life from the grave and crowns you with steadfast love and mercy,
who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like an eagle's.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates, redeems, and sustains us and all of creation. Amen.
Now if you want to take that water and maybe pour it into the bowl as we do confession and forgiveness together. As loving parents have compassion for their children, God has compassion for us. Confident in God's love, let us confess our sins, remembering now our baptism. Gracious and loving God, you lived for us. We have not lived for you. You have forgiven us. We have not forgiven others. You have loved us. We have not loved others, nor have we loved one another. Take pity on us and forgive us, God. Help us to forgive. Help us to live for you. Help us to love through Christ our Lord. Amen. People of God, our sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. God is merciful and gracious and is Lord of us all. Reconciled to the God who loves us, let us live and love through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let's sing.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us go to God in prayer. O Lord God, merciful judge, you are the inexhaustible fountain of forgiveness. Replace our hearts of stone with hearts that love and adore you, that we may delight in doing your will, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Our first reading today is from Genesis, the 50th chapter. Realizing that their father was dead, Joseph's brothers said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong that we did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you. Now, therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then this brother also wept, fell down before him, and said, "We are here as your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good in order to preserve a numerous people as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." In this way, he reassured them, speaking kindly to them. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. A reading from Psalm 103. Lord, you are full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love.
You will not always accuse us, nor will you keep your anger forever.
You have not dealt with us according to our sins, nor repaid us according to our iniquities.
For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is your steadfast love for those who fear you.
As far as the east is from the west, so far have you removed our transgressions from us.
As a father has compassion for his children, so you have compassion for those who fear you, O Lord.
Our second reading is from the 14th chapter of Romans. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, as they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. All those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or your sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, "As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God." So then, each of us will be accountable to God. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia, alleluia. Hear now the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. But when he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold together with his wife and children and all of his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon the one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, pay what you owe. Then this fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he could pay his debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their Lord all that had taken place. Then his Lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in anger, the Lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Well, good morning, kiddos. Pastor Vicki is here to help me with our children's sermon today. And actually, this really isn't a children's sermon. It's more like children's time because I want to show you a project that I've been working on. Since we are starting school this year, and school looks really different for a lot of kids in our area and actually in the whole country, we thought it would be a really good idea to give you guys some tools to have at home to help with your faith formation. So, Pastor Vicki, do you want to show me the paper that's in our blessing bag? Let's start with this.
All right.
So this is your introduction to your blessing bag. So if you forget everything I say, it's right here when you pick your bag up. All right, let's go with the first thing on our list is our really cool highlighter.
Ooh, it is a cool highlighter.
There's five colors in it. What does it say on it?
I am creative like my creator.
Yes, so this is to help you remember that God gave you a creative mind. You can use this when you are doing your schoolwork. You can use it when you're studying your Bible. But remember that you can do anything that this new year throws at you because you have God on your side and God created your brain and you are capable.
All right.
All right, the next thing on our list is a rock.
Ooh, and they're pretty rocks. Look at that.
Ooh, we painted them. So on one side, there's going to be a cross or some sort of picture, and on the other side, there's words. Yeah. And so on this side, it says faith, but some of the rocks say pray, and some of them say joy or hope.
I love these rocks.
Well, we worked hard on them. So
everybody's is different.
Everybody's is different. So you can just display it on the table like this, or if you're sitting in front of your computer, or if you're lucky enough to be in a classroom right now, or if you're just homeschooled all the time, and you have to be touching something while you're doing your work, you can trace the letters. You can trace the word faith on here, and you can remember that God is with you and that we, hold on, what did I put? I said, remember, Christ is our rock.
It's a good one.
Yeah, that is. We're creative like our creator.
And then what?
Okay, let's see. The next thing on the list is our Bible cards. So there's a stack of cards. All right, so now you have five Bible cards. And these are meant to be able to decorate in your room. You can stick them in your mirror. You can put them in your bathroom or your kitchen. And these are reminders that we can always go to God's word, the scriptures, for encouragement.
And they're good ones. Good choices. Oh, all right.
All right. What's next?
I think it's a cool sticker, isn't it?
It is a cool sticker. All right. This is a picture of Jesus. A picture, right? Because no one actually knows what Jesus looks like. But we do know that Jesus probably had brown skin. This is a picture of Jesus that says, you are loved, and what is Jesus holding?
Communion. communion.
Communion. So we remember that we are in community and communion together. And let me show you where you can put it. So you can put it. This is my daughter's notebook. And so she has it right here on her flap so she can always see it. But you can also put it on like a water bottle or something like that. So the point is to remember that you are loved when you see it. All right. And the last thing is a piece of string, which has been prayed over by members of the church, because we want you to remember that when you make it into a bracelet or into a keychain and you look down and you see it, that your church community loves you and you belong here.
What are these cool things?
Okay, so this is the last part. This is a little more complicated. So we have two options of a candle. Now, every kid gets a bag, but every family gets a candle and a prayer book. So when your parents come by, they can choose. Every design is different and unique, just like every child here is different and unique. And that's so cool. And you can light your candle at dinner time, or you can light it for worship to hold sacred space for holy conversations.
Yeah.
And lastly, this is my favorite part.
This is amazing.
It's our prayer book. And members of the community right here at Zion, and then members of the community at St. Mark in Ypsilanti, wrote these prayers for you all. So sometimes praying out loud is a little bit scary, right?
Mm-hmm.
But if you have these prayers, you can practice praying out loud. And then there's space on the back of them for you to write your own prayers as you get more comfortable.
Those are awesome. And I have to say, Vicar Anna organized all of this, which was a lot of work, and she did it because she really loves you all. So I'm really excited about this. And when can they get these?
So today, if you're watching right now, you should be able to come until noon today outside. And if you can't, if your parents can't come by, I've already gotten some emails. We can drop some stuff off if you are local. So send me your address. We have a couple of volunteers, a couple of teenagers that want to drive by people's houses and drop these on your porch so that you have your blessing bag as soon as possible.
Well, maybe we should do a blessing for these kiddos now. What do
Let's
you think?
Let's do the blessing. That's a good idea.
All right. Pastor Jim, you're going to join us with this blessing.
Okay.
Let's find it. Go ahead.
Well, usually at the beginning of each school year, we do a blessing of backpacks during worship. But as you can see, we have a blessing bag for you. And we know that school is different this year. Some of you are doing school at home, and so we still wanted to celebrate this new beginning. And thankfully, we know that God is always with us, whether we're in the classroom, whether we're at home, in daycare, or somewhere else. And we also know that our God is a God of new beginnings. Some of you will begin a new school year in new classrooms with new teachers. Others might be in a new school year at home or virtual classrooms. Many things may be different this year, but we can find joy in these new beginnings.
So let's pray for all of you, shall we? Thank you, God, for new opportunities to learn and grow, whether it be in an actual classroom, a virtual classroom, or from our homes. Be with our parents, our teachers, leaders, caregivers, and administrators as they guide us into this new school year. Give them the tools and energy to create engaging ways for all of us to learn and grow. Help us to open our hearts and our minds to new ideas, new friends and leaders, and new ways of learning. And when things don't go as planned, help us to rejoice in the newness. When we have technical difficulties, help us to be patient. When we feel lonely or isolated, remind us that you are by our side. And as we begin to explore the unknown of this school year, let us rejoice with new friends and new ways of learning and knowing that you are with us through it all. Amen.
God of joy and light, pour out your blessing upon these students, their families, teachers, and leaders. Bless their backpacks, their Chromebooks, their computers, their iPads, their virtual classrooms, their school buildings, their blessing bags, and all preparations that help build a strong and safe year for everyone. May each of you be a blessing and a light in your new year. Go and light up the world. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, grace to you all in peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus, who has risen from the dead and in the power of our Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, it's good to be back with you all. It's been almost a month since I've been in the pulpit, but it's good to be back. Of all the things as Christians, as we follow Jesus, one of the things that we commonly struggle with is forgiveness. As we begin our worship, we begin with corporate confession and forgiveness, and we hear again that God has forgiven us. Each week as we pray together the Jesus Prayer, we say these words, "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us." In this week's gospel lesson, Jesus is teaching about forgiveness. It seems to be it's been a theme these last few weeks. In fact, last week we were talking about how reconciliation plays an important part in the Christian community. If you remember, Jesus taught his disciples that whenever someone sins against you, you should try and try and try again and again and again to make things right, because the desired result is reconciliation. And we want to bring relationships together that are fractured by the power of sin. But I wonder if that's really what we want or desire. We know we want God's forgiveness, of that we're very sure. However, we're maybe not so sure about the second part, about the way that we forgive others. We know that we're not nearly so quick to forgive others as we hope and pray that God is quick about forgiving us. Today in the psalm, the psalmist said, "The Lord is full of compassion and mercy, slow of anger and of great kindness." I mean, that is great news, because we mess up, we ask God for forgiveness, and we know that the Lord is full of compassion and mercy, and so God forgives us. But what happens when someone does us wrong? When someone does us dirty, they cross us, they say something behind our back, and we feel offended? Maybe not so fast are we full of compassion and mercy. Maybe we're not so slow to anger and filled with great kindness. I think it's kind of the opposite. I think we're pretty quick to anger, and maybe we're full of colorful language. And yet our Lord taught us to pray, "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us." You've heard the saying, be careful what you pray for. You just might get it. In our gospel lesson today, Peter comes to Jesus and asks, "Lord, if someone sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times?" Peter always asks that question that maybe you and I want to ask. Maybe he had heard Jesus talk about forgiveness, and he wanted to know more. And Peter maybe did his homework, because, you know, in the ancient rabbinic tradition, a person should forgive someone who has sinned against them as many as four times. So Peter tries to be a little bit more extravagant. He's added three more times to it. And so he asks, "Should I forgive a person up to seven times, Lord?" You know, seven times is a lot. It's three more than the rabbi suggested. It's a lot of time to turn and forgive someone who has offended you, who has sinned against you. And I anticipate that Peter kind of wanted praise. You know, "God, I was extravagant in my forgiveness." Maybe he was hoping for a pat on the back, a gold star next to his name, you know, or A+ on his forgiveness exam. But that's not what happened. Rather, Jesus turns to Peter and says, "Not seven times, but 77 times." Now, maybe you've heard that differently. New Testament scholars debate whether the Greek text actually means 77 or 70 times 7. But that's really beside the point. Jesus holding up an enormous number, so big that we can't begin to calculate it in terms of forgiveness. But you might be, if you think it's only 77, I mean, could you imagine what's happening there? How many times that is? I mean, what Peter really wants, and what you and I really want, is a rule. We want a measurement. We want a guide. You know, something that says, "Lord, how much should I forgive? This much?" And Jesus says, "No, not this much. Even more. You're not even using the right scale. As far as the east is from the west," the psalmist said. God says we should forgive as far as the east is from the west. It's an enormous amount of forgiveness. Senseless to try to calculate it. But I think we might try. I mean, could you imagine if we actually, you know, kept a count? And you come along, and as you're going along, and all of a sudden, you're up to 75, and you think back, "I remember this person offended me in number 73, I know what they did, 74, I know what they did, 75, yeah, and I only got a couple more to go. And then I can walk away." But here's the thing, if you and I are cataloging every time someone hurts us, and all I'm trying to do is close in on some magical number, have I really forgiven that person? I think today Jesus is calling us to something more profound than waiting for a time in which we can finally just walk away from somebody, give up on somebody. To drive the point home, Jesus tells a very compelling story about a slave who was forgiven an unimaginable amount and soon after refused to extend the same forgiveness to someone who owed him far less. What you and I know is forgiveness is hard work. It's hard to forgive a church council that makes a decision that goes against our beliefs, we think. Members who challenge or oppose our views on human sexuality or on tithing or devotional practices or people who encourage division rather than forgiveness and reconciliation. It's hard to forgive. It's hard to forgive family. It's hard to, in this divided country, to forgive those who hold differing views. Like Peter, we want to make sure that forgiveness doesn't get out of hand. Often we don't really forgive someone or ask for their forgiveness because we really want revenge. We want to return hurt by inverting the golden rule. Do unto others as they have done unto you. We want compensation. We want conditions on forgiveness. Sometimes it's our own pride or maybe even the lack of sense that how much God has forgiven us that keeps us from forgiving. Today the scriptures kind of accuse us. Like Joseph's brothers were afraid of the people who have maybe we have betrayed, how they may react to us. It's hard to look someone in the eye when there's division. Like Paul's readers, we often argue with each other about issues that really don't matter. Like Peter and Matthew, we really want to limit our forgiveness of others. Just give me a calculation. Let's not get this forgiveness thing out of hand. But today we realize the one who is greater than Joseph here, Jesus Christ. The one who is thrown down into a deeper pit than Joseph as he was taken to the cross. Yet it is in our Lord's resurrection that he became a greater source of our forgiveness. And like the fictional king of the parable, God in Christ has forgiven us, each one of us, an impossible debt. I mean, 10,000 talents was something like 150,000 years of salary. Beyond limit. You see, and today the Holy Spirit comes upon us and gives us the will and the power to be enabled to forgive those around us. Because without forgiveness, we couldn't be in any relationships. Forgiveness isn't something that only restores, even frees the one forgiven. Forgiveness also restores and frees the one who forgives. You see, forgiveness creates possibility. It opens a future. It gives us a path that was not even imagined before. Forgiveness gives us life. Now, forgiveness is not denying our hurt. Forgiveness is not an excuse for unjust behavior. And to forgive is not necessarily to forget. Forgiveness is not a matter of letting other people off the hook or saying that what someone did to us no longer matters or that an offender isn't responsible for the consequences of their own actions and the pain they may have caused. That's not true at all. Rabbi Harold Kushner tells a story. He tells about a woman who was in his congregation who came to see him. She was a single mother, divorced, working to support herself and her three young children. She came to the rabbi and said, "Since my husband walked out on us, every month is a struggle to pay our bills. I have to tell my children we have no money to go to the movies while he's living it up in a new state with his new wife. How can you tell me to forgive him?" And Rabbi answered, "I'm not asking you to forgive him because what he did was acceptable. It wasn't. It was mean. It was selfish. I'm asking you to forgive because he doesn't deserve the power to live in your head and to turn you into a bitter person. I'd like to see him out of your life emotionally, as completely as he is out of it physically. But you keep holding on to him. You're not hurting him by holding on to that resentment. You're hurting yourself." The Greek word that we translate forgive literally means to release, to let go, to send away. Forgiveness frees us from extending any more precious emotional and spiritual energy, and it frees us to be new people. Who do you need to forgive? Who do you need to release or let go of that still has you bound? So, what are we going to do with this parable? Is it just a warning to say, hey, forgive or else? Is it a lesson? You know, the first servant is already tortured by the inability to live as a free and forgiven person. Is it encouragement? Kind of negatively. You know, don't be like the unforgiving servant who is preoccupied by the debts of others. He missed the great forgiveness he had received. Or is this simply a description of just how hard forgiveness can be? Because we know forgiveness is hard work. It's hard to let go of grievance. Because often, those who have offended us have left their mark on us. They have become part of our identity, part of the story that we tell ourselves and about ourselves. It's hard to let go of a habit to keeping track, of counting, of always assessing and making sure we're getting what we think we deserve. So what are we going to do with a passage like this other than say, hey, you ought to forgive? Maybe it's simply hearing this. You have been forgiven. You will be forgiven. All things, the things you've done, the things you've not done, everything, always. And one other important part of the story comes a little bit later on. It's part of the story that you know about. It's about Peter and the disciples and Jesus at the Last Supper, where Jesus stands among them and raises the cup and says, this is the blood of the covenant, and this is for the forgiveness of sins. You know, those words are only found in the Gospel of Matthew. They're not in Luke. They're not in Mark. They're not in Paul's stories about the Last Supper. But in Matthew, on the evening when his disciples will betray, deny, and abandon Jesus, standing like a promise that even when we fail to live into the grace that Jesus offers, even when we fall short of extending to others the forgiveness we have received, God is still there, forgiving, loving, calling you back home. You see, I think today Jesus is reframing the whole question about forgiveness. When it comes to forgiveness, we are all like servants who owe the Lord and King more than we could ever imagine. And try as we may to repay our debt through our character, through our strengths, through our virtues, or our willingness to forgive as many as 7 times, we'll never be able to repay back all that we owe God. But the good news is that despite our inability to ever give back to God everything we ought, God forgives us anyway, and completely. In the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, God has taken God's self, all the burdens and sins and debts, and has forgiven them, and cast them as far from us as the east is from the west. Completely, they're gone, irrevocably, utterly forgiven, and you have been healed by Jesus. You see, it's not so much that God's forgiveness is contingent upon our forgiving others as our forgiving of others performs our acceptance of God's forgiveness. We forgive then because God forgives. The forgiveness that we pass on to others is the forgiveness that we have in Christ when we are joined in Christ in the waters of baptism, not because we're some moral person, not because we're seeking our own well-being, but because we are forgiven sinners. Jesus reminds us that when it comes to our ability and need to forgive, we are simply all debtors kneeling at the foot of the cross. But it was on the cross that Jesus looked out and said, Father, forgive them. If you and I fail to forgive, it does have effect on the other person, but nothing like the effect it has upon us. If we really want inner spiritual health and the ability to love as Jesus commanded us to love, then you and I must learn to forgive as we have been forgiven. You know, a Presbyterian pastor, Thomas Long, wrote this. He said, We all know too well that the little boat in which we are sailing and is floating on a deep sea of grace, and that forgiveness is not to be dispensed with an eyedropper, but a fire hose. May this community of Zion Lutheran be known as a forgiving community. May we live into the words we pray, "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us." Who is the indwelling Spirit of God calling you to forgive? Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. May it be so. Amen. Today we're also taking a moment to celebrate the faithful work of Diane Reinhardt, who has been our parish administrator as she begins retirement at the end of this month, and so we wanted to take a moment to celebrate her and the work she has done among us. We begin with a reading from Ecclesiastes.
For everything there is a season, a time for every activity under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to harvest, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build up, a time to cry and a time to laugh, a time to grieve and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather stones, a time to embrace and a time to turn away, a time to search and a time to quit searching, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be quiet and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace.
Diane has been here since my whole time, but I remember when I came 6 years ago, it was September of 2014 when I interviewed here, and Diane was one of the first staff people I met other than the call team, and she has been a gift ever since, guiding me through the season of my time here. But she's also been a time for you as well, been that voice on the line of the phone or at the other end of an email, through all the different seasons of your lives, from those times in which you were celebrating great joys of calling in and sharing about a birth, a baptism, a wedding, or those other times of our lives when there was surgery, a hospitalization, a funeral. Diane has been there. She has been part of God's grace to you from this congregation. She has been a source of grace as well for my time here, as she helped guide me when I didn't know very many people and didn't know whatever was going on, and she guided me through all those, and I am thankful for her time among us as a friend, but also as a colleague, in the many ways that she has blessed this congregation and allowed me, certainly, as well as the other staff, to do ministry among us. So we will miss you, Diane, and we are thankful for the time that you journeyed with us doing ministry here at Zion.
And what you may or may not know is Diane's job description was a whole lot longer than anybody would expect. She was way more than someone who answered phones. She was the face of Zion, is still the face of Zion. For any outsider that called in, she was the welcoming committee. And we are so grateful for the warmth and the kindness that she showed everybody. And in particular, when we extended an invitation to our community and we started our God and Grub ministry, Diane was the one who strapped on an apron and started cooking the meals and started loving on all of our friends from the homeless population. And it became this cornerstone of our ministry. People who would come in for lunch, they didn't want anybody else to cook. They wanted Miss Diane to cook. And it was almost like they were coming home and having mom give them a hug. And that's what she has been for not only those individuals of our community, but I know for me, every time I would come in the morning, I looked forward to our conversations and the way she kind of kept us all feeling loved, even in the midst of the tough times. She would send words of encouragement, and she was always a learner. Di would make it a point to send me deep theological thoughts and questions, and she and her sister would ask me these things, and they'd say, I know you're busy, but could you answer this question? And it allowed for these beautiful learning opportunities. So I've always admired that about Di. She was more than somebody who just sat at a desk. She was so involved in the life of this church. So she is going to be sorely, sorely missed by me, I know, but I'm certain all of you. So if you haven't gotten a chance to say goodbye to Di or wish her well, we are at our 1010 service today going to be honoring her. You can come to the drive-in and wave to her and give her some love. Or you can continue to send emails and notes and cards and love in any way that you see fit. So even if it's after this month, we know where to find her. We can get it to her. So why don't we say a prayer? Gracious God, we thank you for the work and witness of your servant Diane, who has enriched this community and brought gladness to friends and family. Now bless and preserve her at this time of transition, day by day. Guide her and give her what is needed, friends to cheer her on her way, and a clear vision of that to which you are now calling her. By your Holy Spirit, be present in her pilgrimage, that she may travel with the one who is the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus Christ our Lord. So Lord, we ask for your blessings upon she and John as they begin their future together. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Drawn together in the compassion of God, we pray together for the church, the world, and all those in need, responding to each petition with the words, receive our prayer. God of open arms, make Christians into signs of your gracious welcome to both members and newcomers, whether meeting physically or digitally. Strengthen faith through Bible studies and Sunday schools, confirmation classes, and youth ministries, and nurture new ventures for education and growth. Bless bishops, pastors, and deacons for their work in this unprecedented time. O God, you are full of compassion.
Receive our prayer.
God of lands and seas, continue your care for your creation. Where human selfishness has brought ruin and destruction, we ask you to heal and renew your earth. Preserve the lands from fire and storm. Protect the sources of food that your creatures need for life.
We especially pray for all touched by the fires out west and for all those fighting the fires. Oh God, you are full of compassion.
Receive our prayer.
God of justice, lead the nations away from the ways of violence. Guide the United Nations and other organizations that seek reconciliation across national borders. Show families, neighborhoods, and nations how to welcome diversity while sharing common ground. Preserve our election season from abuse and rancor. O God, you are full of compassion.
Receive our prayer.
God of our homeland, visit the American cities that are addressing local racism. Stand with both protesters and police, that civil society may be preserved and improved. Bring both healing and justice to our land. O God, you are full of compassion.
Receive our prayers.
God of the sufferers, visit prisons and care homes with health and hope. Free victims of human trafficking and forced labor. Deliver all who are bound by debt. Feed all who hunger and provide safety to migrants. Protect firefighters and first responders. Heal the sick, especially those we name here before you. June, Stephen, Dave, Lori, Karen, Torin, Kathy, Emily, Marilyn, Kale, Jeff, Elaine, Jim, Dee, Julie, Chris, Claudia, Diane, and all those we name in our hearts. Oh God, you are full of compassion.
Receive our prayer.
God of goodness, once more we beg for a way through the pandemic. Comfort the afflicted, support medical workers, and prepare a vaccine. Oh God, you are full of compassion.
Receive our prayer.
God of tender power, we live to you. Hear now, we pray, the desires of our hearts. O God, you are full of compassion.
Receive our prayers.
Whether we live or whether we die, we are yours. We thank you for those who have led us in the faith, especially those we commemorate this week. John Chrysostom, Bishop Cyprian, Hildegard of Bingen, and Dag Holmazad. Hold us with them in your everlasting love. O God, you are full of compassion.
Receive our prayer.
All these things and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to your mercy through Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen. And now as we move into our offering time, this is a way for us to remember that God is unfailing in his blessings and in God's love to us. And so as we are blessed by the Lord, it is our time to give back a portion of that blessing. And we as a Zion staff want to give you great thanks for the way you continue to be amazing stewards. Because of your generosity, our ministry is flourishing and we are able to be the church in the world. So enjoy this offering song.
Oh,
What a beautiful offering song. Thank you, Megan, Alex, and Elgin. All right, let us go to God in prayer again. Oh God, we thank you for these gifts. Multiply them and enable the work of love and the righteousness of your kingdom in the world. We thank you and praise you. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. All right, we have some announcements. First of all, the Portals in Prayers and Christ in Our Home prayer booklets are available. If you swing by here to any of our drive-in services, you can grab them then. If you would like to stop in the office during the week, you can do that. Or if you'd prefer we dump them into the mail and you get them in 2 weeks, we can also do that. Just let us know, send us an email, or let us know via text. We also have beautiful flowers that are behind us. These are to the glory of God in memory of Donald and Dorothy Blair, by Barbara Blair and Connie McComb. So thank you for blessing us with those. Amen. Tomorrow night on Monday evening, Pastor Jim will start his Bible study on the book of James. That begins at 7 p.m. But that is part of our bigger series of education that is being launched today for our entire conference. So if you go to our website, you'll find a link to that. This takes place on Sunday mornings. It also happens on Wednesday evenings. Sundays at 10, Wednesdays at 7, and then we have during the week different things like Pastor Jim's Bible study at 7. I have a live prayer event on Fridays at 4. And if you go on our website, you will see a list of all of the offerings for this countywide adult education forum. Of course, youth and children are invited, but this is really geared toward the adults because next week we have today all of our youth is kicking off as well. All of our youth is kicking off. We have our youth group on Sunday nights. We have high school at 5 p.m. That is via Zoom or in person, your choice. Middle school is Wednesday evenings at 5 p.m. Same choice, in person or on Zoom. So we are kicking off our Bible land, everything. Today would normally be our big fun rally day, but we're going to do it virtually, and that's okay. We can do that. We have our flu shot happening on the 17th this week, actually. So if you haven't been by the church, there's signs out front that tell about it. You're invited to come in. We have it all done very, very safely. You can come and get your flu shot that way. Next Sunday, we are kicking off our confirmation. For those of you in 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, we are having an informational meeting at 1 p.m. Next Sunday via Zoom. So we will have that link up on our website this week. And again, don't forget to come by and say hello to Diane today if you have a chance or any time before the end of the month. Whew, a lot of announcements.
All right. Well, go now into the world, into your schools, into your homes, into your work, and be Christ-like. Be the light of joy for a new school year, for new friends, new ways of learning. Go into the world and shine bright with kindness, patience, energy, love, and forgiveness. Love God, serve God.
Love all, serve all.
And the blessing of God be with you. The love of Jesus fill you. And the power of the Holy Spirit sustain you now and forevermore.
Amen. Amen.
at peace, remember the poor. Thanks be to God.